As I said at the beginning, we are going to be looking at the Anabaptists tonight, and that's the second to the last one in regards to the Reformation. And two of the main issues you're going to find that come out, if you grab your Bibles real quick, Galatians 6, I just want to read a couple of verses from there. And one of them is Anabaptist, Anna meaning again, to baptize. And those that were in the time, they would have denied the fact that they were that way. That idea was given to them, that label was placed on them by others who are saying you're baptizing a second time. But from really their perspective is that they were baptizing in accordance with Christ really once. They weren't baptizing again. They were baptizing in a biblical concept where the Bible says believe and be baptized. And so that was one of the issues that they were dealing with. And the second one was really the mixture between tradition and when it comes to the government, because these were national churches, so that there was a blending between what you would call faith and the legalities of the secular world. And I just want to read a couple of verses from here. Verse 14 of Galatians 6, Paul writes, But God forbid that I should boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. Let me read that again. But God forbid that I should boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails anything but a new creation. And so this concept that you could take a world system and blend it with the church, that the idea of having the government govern the faith and conscience of believers, it was a growing resistance to that idea. So that even with those that were believers, that things like going to war on behalf of the state became a conflict of conscience, because I'm not here to serve in that capacity. I'm here to serve Christ and to follow him. And so there were many groups that kind of developed these ideas, but they were not popular when they began. And many of them were actually killed for their faith as heretics. And so things that you might take for granted of being a conscientious objector or being part of a church, we're not our church here is not part of the national church. We would be considered nonconformists because they're not Church of Wales or Church of England, which is the government-sanctioned church. And in these days, they're going through. There's some good people in them, but we even heard one of the gentlemen yesterday speaking from the Church of England, and he said that many in his own denomination are abandoning basic biblical truths. But this is a governed church where the Queen herself is head of the church. And so this concept that you could have these two blend and have a pure church, over time you can find in lots of different places in the world that these things begin to fail because there's woven through them concepts and ideas that are foreign to Scripture. And being able to die to the necessity of the government system, the world system, to dominate me or to seek its approval, to seek its blessing, to seek its help, rather than from the God who made you. And Paul here says it's through the cross that I've died to that necessity. And that pull that the world had on me, it doesn't pull anymore. A dead man isn't pulled in that direction. He says, I've died to that. And the affections of my heart are not gripped by the things that they seem to offer me. And so as we watch tonight, you're going to find that these are your brothers and sisters. These are the ones that have paid a cost for you to be able to have your Bible, to believe freely, to believe in by conscience in the sense over the Word of God being governing that which you believe, and not to have tradition or even the laws of man to determine if you're a heretic and to execute you. Now, one day these things may come up. In fact, they're coming up in a lot of ways now of being tolerant. That's the word that they're using. That if you're intolerant and you don't agree with them, then you become the intolerant one. Really, that's their intolerance. And the freedom to be able to believe as you understand. And that's not given. That's a big issue, and it's going to get worse in our day. And so the world really has to be crucified to you and you to the world. Otherwise, we'll give way and we'll want the approval of or seek those things and not stand firm in our faith in the Lord Jesus. And so, Doug, you about ready? Okay, excellent, excellent.
If warring was right, I would rather take the field against so-called Christians, if, as you state, Turks know nothing of the Christian faith, then they are but Turks of the flesh. But you, you who would be Christians yet persecute Christ's followers with a sword, you are Turks of the Spirit.
You arch heretic! You have seduced pious people! It would be better if you had never been born!
I'm at the Grossmünster in Zurich, where Ulrich Zwingli launched the Reformation in Switzerland. From here, another branch of the Reformation also shot forth. It's called the Radical Reformation, or the Anabaptists. Anabaptist means rebaptizer. Some of Zwingli's eager young students had studied the scriptures and come to the conclusion that infant baptism was not in the Bible, and that only those who had decided for themselves to become a follower of Christ should be baptized. Look up high on this church at something that symbolizes at least part of the reason for the division that developed here. There you see a statue of the Emperor Charlemagne. He is said to have ordered the construction of this church back in the 8th century. This illustrates how the linkage between church and state had been taken for granted for centuries. It was exactly this state-church relationship that the Anabaptist came to so vigorously oppose. The first Anabaptist, Zwingli's own students, were caught up in the exhilaration of Zwingli's reforms. But they said Zwingli was dragging his feet and going too slow. Zwingli, on the other hand, felt these young men wanted to go too far and too fast. He insisted on government involvement related to major changes in the church. After all, according to Zwingli, it was the city council that had made the Reformation in Zurich possible in the first place. So, when the question of infant baptism could not be resolved within the church, Zwingli brought it to a public consideration before the city council on January 17, 1525. The council upheld infant baptism, and those who wouldn't accept this decision were told to change their minds, or leave, or stay and face arrest. On January 21, 1525, just a few days after the public debate and the city council's warning, the young dissidents met in the home of Felix Mantz in Zurich. Mantz was the son of a priest at the Grossmünster. They considered their alternatives, whether to stay in Zurich or to flee. But then something else happened, something that launched a new chapter in the history of Christianity.
Baptize me.
Baptize it? Brother, I cannot.
Oh, yes, you can, and you must.
Why?
We've been ordered to submit the unbaptized for baptism, am I right?
Yes, of course.
Yes. Yes.
By rejecting the baptism of infants, am I not rejecting my own?
If we defy the council, we will be imprisoned.
Not imprisoned. Freed. George is right.
Better a prison of stone than a prison of false conviction.
Baptize me, brother.
Rebaptism is a crime.
Oh, not rebaptism, but a first true baptism. Brother George, are you sorry for your past sins?
Oh, that's a lot to be sorry for.
That is, and I am.
By accepting the sign of baptism, is it your choice to now proclaim your faith before God and in the presence of these witnesses?
It is. God, help me be strong.
Then I baptize you, George Blaurock, in the name of God, Christ Jesus, the Holy Spirit. Give me your hand, brother. Brother George, as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of God, so walk from this day forth in newness of life.
The unthinkable had happened. To question the legitimacy of infant baptism in that age was to defy the authority of the church and its clergy, whether Catholic or Protestant. It was considered nothing less than an act of treason. Now things began to move incredibly fast. This is the village of Zollikon, just outside of Zurich. On Wednesday, January 25th, just 4 days after the first rebaptism, more than 30 people had already joined the movement. They established the first Anabaptist congregation here in this village. Then, 4 days later, on Sunday, George Blaurock came here to the village church. George was the one that we saw who was the first to be rebaptized. George barged into the church, interrupts the service, and tries to preach the sermon. The local bailiff stopped him. The next day, 15 members of Zollikon's congregation were arrested and thrown in jail. In the meantime, another development was taking place that would soon prove important to the new Anabaptist believers. It concerns a monk named Michael Sattler. He was prior, second only to the abbot, at St. Peter's Monastery in the Black Forest. We'll take up the rest of our story through his experience.
In his position as prior, Michael Sattler had the miserable task of enforcing the collection of taxes from the poor peasants. He went through a long, soul-searching struggle, and so did his friend, a Bedouin nun named Margaretha.
Well?
Well, I've done a lot of thinking lately.
You think too much.
About the church.
As always.
It's been difficult for us, hasn't it?
It's always been difficult for monks and women. Natural enemies.
I don't want it to be that way.
Well, that's a comforting thought.
I have something to tell you, Margaret.
I'd be surprised if you didn't.
I'm leaving.
Leaving what?
The monastery. The church.
The church? Oh, my God.
I've thought a long time about this. You boldly told me that those walls of St. Peter's were very safe. You said that I never even had to look outside if I didn't want to. Well, I never wanted to. But lately, I can't look anywhere else.
Leaving the walls is one thing, but leaving the church, that's quite another.
I would never force your conscience, Margaretha.
It's not not mine I'm thinking of, Michael. You'll be a marked man. You cannot stay in Austrian territory.
I know. I just had to... I had to see you before I left to say... To tell you... To say...
Farewell.
You have no mercy.
Perhaps if you'd ask for mercy.
I don't even know where I'll go. I just know... I have to seek the peace that eluded me in the monastery. I still can't offer title. I can't even offer security or comfort, but I can offer would offer you my hand in marriage.
You are asking me to come with you.
We felt something for each other once before you entered the Beguinage and I the monastery. I had hoped. Do you? Can you still feel something for me?
Deepest price that I have had to pay the church was not being able to express my feelings for you.
If you go with me, you may pay a steeper price for your affection.
Yes.
You ready to risk all to go with me? Margaretta.
Michael. I bless you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Michael and Margaretha were now married, but spiritually isolated from the only world they had known. They soon came into contact with the early Anabaptists, and they cautiously examined their radical teachings. Michael and Margaretha pondered, was this what they both had been so long searching for? Meanwhile, to support his family, Michael took up weaving.
One bad thread.
Pardon?
I sewed the board of the single dyed thread, and it took over the bolt.
So you've learned a lesson?
No. We just keep making the same mistake. Over and over.
Michael, I don't think it's...
It takes only one bad thread to ruin the entire fabric, don't you see? We weave man's authority into God's and the church is corrupted.
But we do have to live in the world.
In the world, perhaps. But not of it.
Is that possible?
That's the truth of baptism. Leaving the kingdom of the world.
And joining the kingdom of God.
Yes. When I was a prior, I split my vows between Christ and the Duke. Luther, he divides his loyalty with the German state, Zwingli his counsel. Wilhelm is right. A baptism of choice signals that we break with the world in matters of faith.
But Wilhelm had his peasants.
Yes. The sword. When we accept its power, we invite its corruption.
How can we avoid that?
By forming a church separate from the power of the sword. The apostles had no duke, no prince.
And no guarantees. What can you say to a woman who wants safety for her children? What guarantee can you offer a man for his family?
Faith. Only faith.
As Christ was raised from the dead, so walk in the newness of life.
Rebaptism spread from village to village as new recruits joined the ranks.
One eager young convert even demanded that early Anabaptist leader Conrad Grebel baptize him here in the Rhine River at Schaffhausen. And that happened to be in the middle of February. That kind of incident helps us to understand perhaps why they were called radicals. It also helps us to understand why the Anabaptists loved to repeat the words they heard first from Ulrich Zwingli, that the Word of God is as unstoppable as the Rhine. This was a time when the Turks were pushing across Europe from the east and leaving a devastating path of destruction in their wake. The Anabaptists, at the same time, were coming to the conviction that violence was wrong and contrary to the gospel. So many of them refused to take up weapons to fight the Turks. This meant that Anabaptists were now seen as far more than religious heretics. They were traitors as well. Still, their numbers continued to grow, but they were understandably disorganized and fragmented. How do you unify a people that is on the run, meeting in secret, and in constant danger of arrest?
Now, Felix, drown!
A secret meeting of Anabaptists was convened at the Swiss border town of Schleitheim in January of 1527. Believers slipped in from Switzerland, Germany, and Austria. Michael Sattler emerged as the leader to bring the diverse groups together.
Many of you know I am a weaver. For many years, the good Lord protected the world from my obvious talents as a weaver by confining me to a monastery. But somehow I escaped. And I managed to spin some cloth. And I brought this specimen here today. Tell me, what would you give me for this?
A broken barrel.
Or a dead goat.
You're a sensible people. You can see that the cloth is ruined, and you won't waste your good earnings to buy it. One of the first things I learned when I began weaving was that it takes only one bad thread. Only one poorly mixed dye to destroy an entire cloth. Like my brother Wilhelm, I'm afraid. I fear for those in prison. I weep for those who have died and will die as Anabaptists. But I fear even more the consequences of compromise. For if we allow the power of this world to be threaded into the fabric of Christ's church, all of us, we've seen the results. Compassion turns to pride, charity to greed, truth becomes fabrication, salvation citizenship, peace oppression, and faith in God becomes faith in popes and princes and kings. We must not imitate the world, but Christ in all things, even if we are called to the gallows or the grave. When I made this mistake, it cost me only 4 guilders. If we deceive ourselves now, the price will be eternal. How are they?
They wait.
The following articles that we have dealt with in which we have been united as brothers and sisters in our Lord Jesus Christ. To baptize those who have repented of their sins and have made an adult and voluntary commitment to follow Christ. To swear no oaths of any kind. To reject the sword as outside the perfection of Christ. And finally, to separate ourselves so that good and evil, believing and unbelieving, darkness and light, the kingdom of God and the kingdom of this earth, none will have part with the other. It is not enough that we leave this place in simple agreement. We must go forth fully committed to the course that we have set here. Under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, we must go out as sheep amidst wolves, as lambs to the slaughter. How say you?
Amen.
Amen.
The Brotherly Agreement, or Schleitheim Confession, became the charter of the Anabaptist movement. It did much to give them strength within their ranks.
What is that?
But it did nothing to lessen the opposition from without.
We've been found.
Quietly, quickly, out the back.
Wilhelm, I can't find Mary.
Comforts of the monastery that you left, but perhaps better able to give your soul direction. Crude tools should not be necessary among men of refinement. It's one thing to risk your own hand. What about the others? But then, how can you bear to watch them suffer?
How can you bear to cause their suffering?
Michael, I'm not a cruel man by nature, but I will do whatever is necessary for the Empire and the Church.
And I'm not a brave man, but I have chosen, along with my brothers and sisters, to suffer whatever is necessary for the sake of truth.
Truth! This is not truth! This is heresy!
I pray that you turn from your ways while there's still time.
I'll run you through. You and your people, one by one, if I have to. Think about it. Quickly, before time runs out. Get back to his cell. Michael, you say marriage is of God.
Yes.
Were your vows confirmed only between yourself and God?
No. Also before a minister.
Under whose jurisdiction?
The canton of Zurich.
By an instrument of the devil?
I have not claimed that.
You refuse to honor the authority of government?
I am bound by scripture to submit to dukes and princes.
Ah, so government is ordained of God.
Yes.
Yet you refuse to take up the sword in defense of your land.
In matters of conscience, Christ's followers must choose God's laws above man's.
So man may choose by conscience which laws to obey and which to disregard. The state would crumble if it allowed such freedom.
Unless Christ's followers claim such freedom, the church with us.
Each day, Ferdinand fights the Antichrist at our throats. Do you deny this?
We do not know that the Turks are the Antichrist.
We know that they are Turks.
Yes.
Infidels.
So I have heard.
Barbarians completely without Christ.
I cannot judge that.
Is it true, as reported, that you say you would prefer to fight on the side of the Turks against the Christians?
Order. Let the accused reply.
Have I spoken your words?
My meaning was...
Answer the court!
I said that if warring was right, I would rather take the field against so-called Christians if, as you state, Turks know nothing of the Christian faith, then they are but Turks of the flesh. But you who would be Christians yet persecute Christ's followers with a sword, you are Turks of the Spirit.
You arch heretic! You have seduced pious people! It would be better if you had never been born!
God knows what is good.
Desperate villain, I tell you, if there were no hangman here, I would hang you myself and know that I had done God's service.
God will judge.
Is there no argument that can convince you of the error of your ways?
I can only be convinced by Scripture.
Arch heretic! The hangman will convince you!
In the name of the Empire, Michael Sattler, heretic and seducer, shall be committed to the executioner. The executioner is first charged to cut the heretic's tongue from his mouth. Glowing iron tongs shall tear the seducer's flesh 7 times between his first ordeal and the fire. And then his body shall be burned to powder as an arch heretic.
Gunpowder.
Hurry up.
Two days after Michael Sattler was burned on the bank of the Neckar River, Margaretha, his wife, was taken here to the same river and drowned. The Anabaptists were sought out, hunted down, and killed. To survive, they had to meet in secret. The persecution of Anabaptists would continue for 200 years in Europe, but somehow their movement continued even as their best leaders were captured and executed. Historians today recognize that Anabaptists were crucial in giving to the modern world such concepts as the separation of church and state, religious toleration, and nonviolence. And today there are over a million Anabaptist descendants in groups such as the Mennonites, the Hutterites, the Amish, the Brethren in Christ. And there are many millions more in the so-called free church movements who trace their spiritual influence through the lines of the Anabaptists.
Any comments, thoughts, questions? People from Turkey? Sorry. The thing was is that during that time that there was a lot of wars going on, and anyone who isn't Christian, my guess is that probably would have been I think they would have been Islamic, really, because that would have begun, huh? The Ottoman Empire? Is that what it was? Yeah. So you have all sorts that were going on there. And when church and state are one, then war by a government becomes a religious war. Yeah. So the concept that we live in a Christian nation, ever heard that? Yeah. Is there such thing? Think about it. Is there such thing as a Christian nation? See, when we go to India, people in India believe this is a Christian nation. Yeah. So citizenship is the same thing as believing in Jesus. Some people believe, you ask them, are they Christian? They'll say, yeah, I'm a British person. I'm a citizen. That's what makes me Christian. That doesn't make anyone Christian. Is there such thing as a Christian nation? So that the head of the nation is actually the head of the church, or should be. When you begin to do those things, and this is what you find that down through history, that those who thought like that and tried to make a Christian area, a place that was entirely Christian, run by governmental rules, then the ideas of ruling and secular kinds of government, that concept interwoven with the church. So then if you disagreed with something that was taught from the pulpit, now you're not just going against, in a sense of conscience, you're breaking legal laws, which will put you in prison. And we see these kinds of concepts everywhere. Everyone wants to make it back into a theocracy. Israel was the only nation governed by God, and they didn't even do very well, did they? Right? And so we think that making a nation a Christian or having it governed by Christian rules, the thing is, even in a democratic system where we have, now in the UK it's more republic rather than democratic, it's we vote for those and they go in, they make their own decision. A true democratic system is where each individual person has a say. All of those things have to be governed by absolutes. So that there's freedom, as it were, in between. So that we're governed by absolutes that go above us. Now, those things can be implemented as a way of law and a way of justice, but it doesn't make a nation Christian. People say, well, the United States is a Christian nation. It's not a Christian nation. There isn't such thing. Now, you can have people that are in government that are believers in Jesus, and they try to, that their faith would activate, but how lead them as they're making decisions, but to live in a nation where you'd say, well, actually, you have to believe this, otherwise you're going to go to prison. What's the difference between that and any other totalitarian system? And if you don't believe like we do, then you'll die. But see, when you have moral absolutes that are supposed to govern a people, and that's where Francis Schaeffer picks up a lot of this, if you've ever heard of him, in his one of his books, A Christian Manifesto. And his conclusion was basically that without the absolutes, that a nation will end up totalitarian like that. So I'll give you an idea how this works. So if I say to you, well, you're not supposed to do that. At one point in time, we could say, well, when someone says, well, why shouldn't I do that? It's wrong. Well, who says it's wrong? Okay, don't steal. Who says it's wrong? Okay, but that's an authority that goes above you and me. That's an absolute. So those are like rails on the road. But nowadays, you can't say that. So now it's only wrong if you get caught. Right? Government officials steal. Is it wrong? Well, if they get caught, what makes it morally wrong? Without God, there is no moral. So what happens is that let's say that I have a law and someone says, well, why is that right or wrong? Why is it morally or ethically wrong? And say, well, God says, well, you can't say God anymore. So then who makes the decision? Well, I do. Well, why do you make? Because I have a bigger army than you do. I have more power than you do, and I can make you submit. Now it becomes totalitarian. And that's what happens. And so the mixing of the ideas of a government church, well, then who makes the rules in the church? And often what happens is you find people use the church then for political concepts. You ever played chess? Yeah. You ever notice how they're laid out? You have two rows in the front, so the pawns, all the little people. And then you have the king and the queen. And right next to them you have the bishops, which is the church. And then you have the knights, which are the army. And then you have the castles, or the rooks, which are the castle. It's an interesting picture. Yeah, maybe you've never seen that before. But that idea of the politics of using politics to govern God's people. Remember what happened with Nebuchadnezzar? He wanted God's people to bow and worship. Many, it seems, did, but there were a few who didn't. When you have Constantine coming to power, and he tried to blend the church and the state, and it corrupted things. And these principles still happen today. And so it's interesting. It doesn't mean that someone, I don't move along the lines that certain jobs, as it were, within the government are forbidden as far as being a believer. But there are limitations. What if you're a police officer and you have to decide in situations of morality and ethics as to how to implement that decision that's being placed upon you? I think it could end up with an issue of conscience. They either follow what the state is saying or they follow their conscience and what they believe the Bible teaches. And that's it. Those are issues, and it will come to that one day. When in the Holocaust in Germany, there were many guards there who, when they did, they said, I was just following orders. But in The Hague, when they were on trial, they said that didn't matter. You shouldn't have done it. Because it was an issue of ethics and morality. It's interesting to watch those things play out. And they'll play out again. And they'll play out and are playing out in many places in the world. Any other thoughts? Comments? Now, we as a church here believe in what would be termed believers' baptism by immersion. Yeah, believers' baptism by immersion. So we believe that when someone comes to faith in Jesus Christ personally, I can't bring someone to faith. I can't declare someone Christian. There is no man on earth that can do that, only Christ. He's the one that sees the heart. The Holy Spirit is the one that gives life, right? A priest can't give you eternal life. A pastor can't declare you Christian. When it stands before God, it's not going to work to say, well, my pastor said I was Christian. God will not be impressed. It will be the relationship that you have with him in his son. And so we believe that when someone personally comes to faith, their heart is changed and they've repented themselves. They've put their trust in Christ. That then, whatever age they are, they need to be of an age of understanding, but whatever age they are, then they too can get baptized. And then we do that by immersion.
which means that some of the pictures there, they were sprinkling them. And we believe that when the examples that are given in Scripture, both on two levels, one level is that when Jesus went and baptized in, actually it wasn't him, the apostles baptized in the Jordan, there's at least one, if not twice, it says, and there was much water. It's interesting. And so they went down into the water. If you look at the wording, and so when Philip, in fact, when he baptized the Ethiopian, they went down into the water, they came up out of the water. And so that was that picture. Now we also have the picture of the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ. And so when we baptize, it's someone who goes down under the water. It's a picture of death and burial. And then they're risen up. They come up in the picture of newness of life. And so we believe in believers, baptism by immersion. Does that make sense? And I believe that if someone is come to faith, let's say someone who was a young baby and they were christened, which is often means to make Christian, and let's say that their parents or whatever, they had them baptized. So as a child, you were baptized, and people have asked me this question: Do I believe that someone should be baptized again, or as they were doing there, which was called the Anabaptist? And I had someone in a church when I was pastoring before, who she came to me and said that she wanted to be baptized, and she had come to faith in Christ. Now, the young lady was with us for a little while, and as I began to talk with her and watch her and listen, something didn't seem right to me. There was something missing in her confession of faith. And I was concerned for her, not to prove any points, I was concerned for her. But she was saying, I want to get baptized. And so I remember I went to another pastor who I respected and got counsel. And the advice that I was given, well, if you baptize someone like that, then it's not based on your witness as to what you're believing. It's based on their confession of faith. And so I think I kind of, I don't know if I gave in or what, but I said, oh, okay. So I remember the day that she got baptized, and I baptized her, and I looked at her and I said, well, based on your confession of faith, I didn't point my finger at her, but it was based on your, and I was quite emphasized, based on your confession of faith, because she actually knew where I was concerned about her. Well, about a year or so later, she was in one of the services in the evening, and the Holy Spirit drew really near to her, and he dealt with her heart. Oh, and she struggled. She shook, physically shook. And I could see what was going on as I was preaching. And the Holy Spirit was dealing very strongly with her. And she was weeping, and she was, but there was this, you could see physically, there was this battle going on. And so I decided that I wasn't going to go over and talk to her personally. I sent another young lady who was in the congregation, had been trained up, and I sent her over to talk. Do you know what her number one problem was? I told everyone I was already Christian and I got baptized. But the Holy Spirit was dealing with her heart. And as soon as she let that go and said, no, I wasn't. I wanted to be. It was an honest. And then she came to faith. Genuinely. Oh, and you could see the difference. She had struggled with her assurance for a long time. After that point, that issue on assurance, she knew to whom she belonged. There was no question. Well, she was doing her, I think it was her master's degree, and she went away for about another year and to do her studies, and then she came back. Well, when she came back, she said, Pastor, I'd like to get baptized again. And I began to pray about the issue because I was going to go to my leadership team and tell them, you know, and it was a Baptist church that I was pastoring in. And so as I was praying about it, I came across a passage where in Acts 19, Maybe you'll turn there for just a minute. We'll finish up here in just a few moments. In Acts 19, the Apostle Paul is on his way, and he came to Ephesus. I'm just going to read down from verse 1, and I'll read down through verse 10. And it happened while Apollos was at Corinth that Paul, having passed through the upper regions, came to Ephesus. And finding some disciples, he said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" So they said to him, "We have not so much as heard whether there is a Holy Spirit." And he said to them, Into what then were you baptized?" So they said, "Into John's baptism." Then Paul said, "John indeed baptized with a baptism of repentance, saying to the people that they should believe on him who would come after him, that is on Christ Jesus." When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke with tongues and prophesied. Now the men were about 12 in all. Then he went into the synagogue and spoke boldly for 3 months, reasoning and persuading concerning the things of the kingdom of God. But when some were hardened and did not believe, but spoke evil of the way, before the multitude, he departed from them and withdrew the disciples, reasoning daily in the school of Tyrannus. And this continued for 2 years, so that all who dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord Jesus, both Jews and Greeks. So Paul goes to Ephesus, and he finds a group of people. He says they found some disciples. Then he asks them, really, if they received the Spirit, and they said, "We didn't know." Well, they were baptized by John. That was a baptism of repentance. They were already baptized. But when they came to faith in Jesus, he baptized them, what? Again. And so as I prayed and meditated on that, it was right around the same timing that I read that. And the Lord really assured my heart that baptizing her again was appropriate. Now, at best, her baptism that she had was a desire. She wasn't trying to, I don't think she was trying to fool or lie, but there was a desire for her. She was wanting to be Christian, but it's only the Holy Spirit that gives life. Baptism itself does not bring regeneration. Baptism itself does not give eternal life. It's only faith in the Lord Jesus. And if we baptize children, it might be the desire of the parents to see that their sons and daughters, yeah, I want them to come to faith. Well, they've been baptized then. But when someone comes to faith in Christ themselves, they need to make that personal, public declaration to say, "I belong to Jesus, and I'm following him. I'm denying myself. I'm taking up my cross, and I'm going to follow." And they make that confession, not just before people, but actually that confession of a good conscience is towards God. "I genuinely believe in your Son, that what he did for me was absolutely enough to make me right, to accept me in the Beloved. And my old life, I'm leaving that behind." And you're making that direction, you're making that declaration before men, before people. You're making it before God, and you're also making it before devils and angels. Because what happens when you're saying that to devils, before devils, you're saying, "Listen, your time is short. Jesus has already won the victory. And I've changed sides, and I'm declaring the line, and I'm on his. Jesus said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." And that public declaration, it says that even the angels in heaven rejoice over one sinner who repents. And so our confession is really important. In fact, the Lord Jesus said, "If you confess me before man, I will confess you before my Father who is in heaven. If you deny me before men, I will deny you before my Father who is in heaven. And the baptism, that public confession, is a confessing Christ publicly, saying, I belong to him. Now I know that goes on in our lives, that we continue to confess him. We continue to make clear to whom we belong, both in lifestyle as well as with our words. So here we believe again in believers, baptism by immersion. And so next week, Sunday night, at this time or whatever, you'll find that those who are being baptized are going to stand, they're going to declare their faith in Jesus. They're going to stand and they're going to tell you how they came to faith in Jesus. What we often call a testimony. Some places they call it a witness. But it's their story of how they personally came to know Jesus Christ, what he did for them, how he died, how he rose again, how he dealt with them, how when their eyes were opened, what happened in their heart, how did they respond, and where they're at, the change that he's made. And that's what they'll be sharing. You'll listen for it. And you'll hear what Jesus did. This is a living relationship with the living Christ. This isn't joining a church or a religious group or a denomination. It's coming to know and having faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, coming to know him personally. And then they'll go down into the waters. And underneath the boards here, there's a baptismal pool, which, God willing, will be filled and warmed, hopefully, a bit. And then I'll go down in, and sometimes another leader will go down in with. And I'll say, based on your confession of faith. And they'll stand up here, actually. I'll ask them a couple of questions, and they'll declare their faith. We go down in, and then I now baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We take them down. We don't hold them down for 3 days and nights, which is good. Yeah. Oh, the other way. Sorry. Now baptize you. And up they come. And it's a rejoicing moment. It's a wonderful picture. And if you're coming to next week, or you're maybe watching online tonight and you want to be here, come. Bring a friend. It's a wonderful picture of the gospel being enacted. And there's something really special. And I'd encourage you, if you've not been baptized, if you've put your faith in the Lord Jesus, you belong to him, and you've not yet obeyed that command, well, I would encourage you that you need to obey the Lord Jesus. It's not church. It's not a denomination. It's in the Bible. And the Bible says, believe and be baptized. Yeah, it's important. If it wasn't, Jesus wouldn't have said, do it. And so, any other questions, any comments, thoughts? No? Okay. Just going to pray, and then we'll sing and close for tonight. Father, thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace. Thank you that there are those who have gone before us, that, Father, with a perseverance and a tenacity that we don't see very often in our day, that, Lord, they stood the test, and, Lord, we rejoice with them. Their blood, Father, calls out, Lord, your servant once said, Lord, that the blood of the martyrs is seed for the church. And Lord, in spite of those that perished, your truth kept going. And Lord, the inspiration of your word having that effect that it does on our minds and our hearts to bring us to a reality of that which is true. So we just thank you tonight for your word. We thank you that it has power. Thank you that, Lord Jesus, your words, their spirit and their life. Thank you that you feed us on that bread which is from heaven. Every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And I pray, Lord, that we'll be a people that take hold of your word, read your word, feed on your word, and that it would shape us, and by your Spirit, Lord, you would give us understanding and revelation. It would break chains and change our mind, and we would be those to walk in truth and in light. And help us that we too, with a tenacity of perseverance and faith, that we will stand the tests that we face.
whether large or small, that we would be those to further on and go on and hand on to the next generation a clear and pure gospel that they too would believe. And so we ask your blessing tonight, our Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you for listening. Please feel free to share this message with others, but we ask that you do not charge for or alter the content without permission. For more information, messages and contact details, please go to www.newhopecc.co.uk or download our app off the Apple and Android stores.